If Keith Green's life had to fit into a word, it could only be the word intense. Whatever he set his heart on, he pursued with total abandon.
Like a foolish dreamer trying to build a highway to the sky.
As a child, it was a dream of early stardom. As a teen, it was a desperate passion to find truth. As an adult, it was an intense and deepening hunger to know God. And just before his tragic death, it was the call to take the gospel message to the ends of the earth. It wasn't that Keith Green was the only one in his generation who hungered for truth and righteousness. What set him apart was the bright, burning intensity of his desire.
Keith had this really all-consuming dream his whole life. He wanted to be in show business. He started very young in commercials, and then he was in theater at 8 and in Sound of Music a little older than that. Keith was also in Teen Screen Magazine with this really sort of dreamy-eyed picture saying, you know, here's the next upcoming heartthrob girls. And he was recording at 11 with Decca, and so he was geared to sing in his mind to the masses and just go. His parents really encouraged him. I mean, they were all for this happening for their son.
But it never quite happened. That Decca record died on the shelves. For 4 years, that elusive big break stayed just out of reach. Keith was growing restless with the whole high-pressure Hollywood environment. At 15, he decided that he just needed to get as far from L.A. as $175 in an old van could take him. It was a spiritual journey of sorts, and something he thought he should chronicle.
He started a journal when he was 15, and the first entry is, you know, he says, like, hi, I'm Keith, or Keith Green, I'm running away from home. I remember Keith telling me when I met him that he had run away from home 3 different times, following music and sort of a spiritual path. So he really, you know, was a pretty freewheeling kind of teenager.
This was in the late 60s, when psychedelic experimentation, free love, and cosmic spirituality were changing the culture. Keith began to open himself to new experiences, seeking a cure for his growing spiritual hunger. He didn't care how it came, he just wanted an answer.
Keith met his very best friend, Todd Fishkind, in high school.
When we met in high school, his dad was my algebra teacher. Keith and I had very similar inspirations.
They were both musicians writing their own music, and they were both using drugs to try and have some kind of a spiritual experience and find the truth.
We had decided to start a diary together in October of 1970, and we talked about the Brotherhood movement and all our dreams and aspirations that we shared, all the things that were dear and precious to us.
Me and my brother Todd are musicians and songwriters and children of God. That's what Keith wrote on one of the first journal pages.
It was, I think, the most significant friendship in Keith's early life.
And we'd even get into personal exchanges and diary wars and things of that nature because, you know, we struggled with our egos, we hated this thing in ourselves, but there it was, and it would come out in the diaries as well.
Community was an important idea for Keith, but the abrasive reality of his relationships was often frustrating. Keith continued his own struggle to act with love toward others. He readily opened his life to whoever came in.
There was a music publisher named Peter Burke, who I had some contact with in the early 70s. He told me about this singer-songwriter named Keith Green.
Keith was writing a lot of songs in his early years about love, about searching, you know, what's the truth, God, where are you? He wrote about what was on his heart.
And he said, you know, I think Keith plays at a little club on Wednesday nights called the Blah Blah Cafe in North Hollywood. I think this could be a good songwriting team. I recommend that you go and check him out.
You know, I'm drawing people just like what
the Blah Blah Cafe in the early 70s was possibly the straight-up coolest hang in Hollywood. It was a long, dark, smoky room that couldn't hold more than 100 people without breaking the fire code. It was the kind of place people went just so they could say a couple years later, yeah, I saw so-and-so at the Blah Blah before they made it big.
It had this amazing, diverse clientele. It was just full of talent scouts and, you know, people that were just coming in to enjoy some music. I mean, it was just this whole mixture of people.
As I came through the door, I saw this guy on stage with way too much bushy brown hair tied back in a ponytail and just almost literally tearing the keys off of this piano. I had never seen anyone dominate an instrument with such intensity.
You had this feeling that you sold the house out when there were like 75 people there.
I just sort of stood there with, you know, with my mouth open.
So you had this immediate feeling of success and everybody's with you and clapping along and singing, and there was that immediacy with the crowd.
When he was done, it was the end of his set, and he came off stage, and as I walk up to him, I almost, you know, he almost struck me as like a force of nature or something.
That first conversation at the Blah was like the calm before the storm. Keith immediately invited Randy to come hang at his house in Laurel Canyon.
He really wanted, you know, for me to be his friend, and he really wanted to try to be my friend.
It was the beginning of a deep and friction-filled relationship that revolved around Jesus, rock and roll, and life's big questions.
Even though Keith was raised in the Christian Science faith, he had a Jewish heritage in his family.
Keith would say, "I am like one who sits in a train station and all the trains of thought are going by and I'm not getting on any of them."
He was caught up in the whole hippie scene, you know, of LA, and so everybody was kind of in this spiritual seeking mode at that time.
Spiritual seekers could choose from a limitless universe of options. There was Eastern mysticism, Buddhism, gurus, be here now, metaphysics, and a thousand others.
One of the reasons that Keith took drugs to try and have a spiritual experience was because he knew there was something more. And when he looked around him, he thought, it's not here. So if I can take something that takes me up to a different place, maybe I'll find the truth there.
Some of Keith's drug experiences, however, left him scared.
What was particularly revealing for us was the bottoming out experiences that we would have. Keith had a particularly big one there in 1972 on a bad mescaline trip.
He went out with this man who was a record producer, and they dropped together, and Keith took too much. His friends started convincing him that there were, sounds crazy now, but that there were spaceships coming and aliens, and they were going to come, and there was an appointed time, and they were going to take Keith away. And he had such a frightening and horrific trip that, I mean, it really was his last one, and it shook him up to his very core spiritually.
Keith sensed that the rug had been pulled out from under him. As far as the pursuit of truth went, he suddenly knew he was running. Blind and scared.
Anything of that nature, if it even rang faintly of spiritual, Keith would shut the conversation right down at this point in his life.
When I met Keith, he had ruled out totally all the Eastern mysticism. He was looking for the light, and he was even very skittish about certain things.
I'd say something that rang a little philosophical, and he'd go all grasshopper or something. He'd just kind of make fun of me. And
Keith had waded through philosophy, drugs, and mysticism, and come out the other side with nothing to hold on to. Only a sense that maybe there was something different about Jesus.
Keith told me, everybody thinks Jesus is a good guy. I mean, Buddha says he's okay. The Jewish people say he was a good rabbi.
He started reading the words of Christ, and they penetrated him. Even though he wasn't accepting him in full, it really started to affect him.
Jesus said he was the only way, so he figured, well, I'm going to look into this guy who says he's the only way.
There was at least one part of his life, though, that seemed to fall easily into place.
I remember the day that he met Mel.
It would be impossible to forget the first time I met Keith, because he always made such an impression wherever he went.
He came home from doing some errands, and I happened to be in his living room, I think, playing my guitar. And he said, "Randy, I just met the most wonderful girl." And I said, "Keith, that's what you say every week."
He was probably one of the most like right there, talking to you, bouncy, asking you questions that, you know, you're thinking, I don't hardly know this person. Why is he asking me these questions?
No. This is different. I'm telling you, there's something about her. This is different. And he was right.
Keith pursued Melody with his usual stubborn persistence. Early in their relationship, he wrote, "With our electricity and music through me, we can amplify the beautiful song of us. After all, you are a melody, and I am a minstrel, and we are becoming a fact. Us."
You want to love with me then. I only ask that you still be my friend.
Within months, Keith had moved into Melody's life in a big way.
We started living together. Actually, he moved into my apartment. He started living with me. And so it was all my stuff. And he started just going through it.
They had to work out the rough edges of their relationship. And it got mighty loud sometimes.
My astrology books, my, you know, astral projection books, my all that stuff he thought was so creepy, he didn't want it around. And so he just started going through my place saying, you got to get rid of this, you got to get rid of this.
Trying to sort of be invisible in the middle of this kind of knockdown, drag out thing where they're working out love.
I thought, he's got some nerve. I mean, he's come moved into my house and now he's throwing all my stuff away.
I could see that there was some special connection and real intensity.
I knew he had something I didn't, even though he wasn't fully connected yet. We kind of launched on this spiritual search and romantic search together.
Like hurricane winds picking up speed, every part of Keith's life seemed to be revolving faster and faster around the hunger in his soul. Randy Stonehill often found himself near the center.
Well, Keith and Randy had a lot in common. They were both great musicians, and I know Keith loved that about Randy. They could just jam together and goof around and, you know, just have a wonderful time. And also, Randy talked all about Jesus.
We had some pretty loud conversations. They sort of escalated from conversational form to arguments about spiritual things.
Keith had really taken to the teachings of Jesus. He didn't trust anything else at that point. And this was right about late 73.
Keith was raised reading the Bible, but his understanding that he was taught with certain parts were inspired, certain parts weren't.
And I said, well, Keith, if you believe that Jesus was a great teacher, then you really need to accept all of his teachings. You can't just pick and choose, you know, the things that you're comfortable with and kind of leave the things that bother you or the things you don't understand.
The really good thing about that was that he already had this respect for Jesus, but he didn't have a full understanding of who Jesus was.
During this time, Keith made an enigmatic journal entry. Jesus, you are hereby officially welcomed into me. Now only action will reveal your effect on me. Keith was reaching for something that he didn't yet comprehend.
We didn't know about all the others, you know, all the other gurus and swamis and masters and so forth, but we were going to let Jesus be our guru. We knew that was safe. We sensed safety in Jesus.
Keith found Christians and their beliefs unsettling. After visiting a Jesus freak coffee house, Keith angrily vented in his journal. They tried to trip on me about believing the whole Bible, word for word, and I just don't believe that. I'm still trusting my bro, Jesus Christ. Keith's simultaneous hunger for and misunderstanding of the gospel set up an ironic tension in his life.
We had a huge fight at the Blah Blah one night when we got our rings and he wanted to get little crosses engraved on them. I did not want a cross on my ring. I'd never even heard the gospel message. It was a big deal. I had to make the connection. But Keith was adamant about it. Keith wanted to be married on Christmas, in honor of Jesus, in Jesus' name. So we were already living together. We just got up, drove down to Coldwater Canyon, where there was this little chapel called the Little Brown Church. It was one of those 24-hour places. And we eloped. Todd was the only other person there.
For Keith and Melody, the newlywed months were spent trying to iron out their young relationship, figure out the meaning of life, and somehow pay the bills.
The first year we were married, we were pretty broke, and I wasn't working. Keith didn't want me to work. So we were living off of what he made playing clubs, proms, and, you know, parties, those kinds of things where you go play, nobody listens, and real kind of bottom of the barrel for musicians. But we were doing anything to survive.
Keith's generous habit of opening their home meant there was usually someone else along for the ride.
Keith could give me a hard time quite often, but he was also this warm-hearted, generous guy who actually invited me to come and live with him when I was discouraged and broke and really didn't have any place to go.
He needed a place to stay. So he ended up sleeping on our fold-out couch, which, trust me, was not comfortable in our living room for a while.
And I thought, well, this could be a mixed blessing. but still, it was very sweet. And I said, oh, okay.
Randy's constant presence in Keith and Melody's lives proved to be pivotal as their spiritual searching came to a head. During the last half of 1974, an increasingly frustrated Keith wrote, "There's metaphysical Christians and Jesus freaks that scream, but there's no confused Christians like me. I love the goal so thoroughly that I'd give up anything if I were sure about the path."
Keith and I got to a point where we really started visiting churches and trying to, you know, find a more traditional Jesus.
At the time, I was involved in a church group that was extremely intense and restoration-oriented.
We visited there and didn't quite like it, but thought, oh, these people kind of like Jesus, maybe we'll go back. But Randy had been telling us, why don't you come to this Bible study that I go to? It's just at someone's house.
I remember after one of our many heated spiritual discussions thinking, you know, maybe he'd get a clearer picture of the gospel if he went to this Bible study.
Randy Stonehill was one of the first musicians that began coming to the Friday Night Fellowship.
We didn't quite want to go because we weren't sure we wanted to be Christians. We liked what Jesus said. We thought he was very cool.
I almost set it up like a dare. I said, Keith, look, I'm going to go out on the road. I've got concerts to do. I'm going to be gone for a couple of weeks. You and Mel, I dare you, just go on up there. And you know what? If you don't like it, hey, you can walk.
I recall Keith and Melody coming one night through the door with a lot of energy, as they typically did, and they had driven nonstop from Riverside, breaking every speed law on the way. He thought it was the Lord's will that they be at the Bible study no matter what happened on the way.
Walking in, all these people were sitting on the carpet and singing worship songs.
They were so crowded together. It was kind of part of the ambiance of that time and part of the excitement.
At the end, when Ken really shared the gospel about, you know, how your sins can be cleansed and it cuts your karma, you start with a clean slate, all of that, you just start fresh and new, and he gave the altar call, Keith raised his hand.
At the end of the Bible study, I recall Keith and Melody, but particularly Keith, kind of cornering me. He asked excellent questions, thoughtful questions, but questions that were much deeper than questions I was used to.
Keith was sold. That was it. It was what he'd been looking for. He knew it, and he was immediately there.
And the next time I saw him, which was at Ken Gullickson's Bible study, he'd become a Christian.
Keith never looked back, convinced that what he found was the real thing. His radar locked onto a new target. Now everyone else had to know.
You know, people use the phrase born again, and it's sort of a cliche, but Keith felt like everything started new that night.
I've never seen such a radical transformation in any human being as much as I saw in Keith.
He had finally found truth that he'd been searching for in his songs, that he'd been trying to get from his family and from the world around him. His hunger seemed more profound than most of ours.
Instead of songs about searching and what's it all about and where am I going, what's my life mean, they became songs of I know God, here he is, and it just reshaped everything.
The only thing it didn't reshape immediately was his audience. Many of the loyal fans who had been so attracted to his spiritual searchings were now offended by his claim to have found an answer. the usual crowd at the Blah did not know how to react.
This is when Keith was on stage talking about how Jesus had changed his life.
He thought, look, the church has enough music. They don't need my music. They've got plenty of music. I want to go out and sing to people who are searching just like I was.
His songs had to do with spiritual things, but never like this night.
He was always sort of an evangelist in one way or another with whatever it was, and now he became like just super evangelist.
So after the first set, I walked out. I thought, forget this. And he followed me out, and he said, you know, what's wrong? And I said, I can't believe that you use this like a church. I was just, you know, so we walked around the whole block, and he, you know, told me about how Jesus changed his life, and I told him I didn't want my life changed.
His motives were good, but there was no tempering. I mean, we were like 2 weeks old in the Lord.
That was the beginning of what I used to call Bible study battles, because it went on for about 2.5 years. My process of conversion, I think, was over that course of those couple of years, from when he became a Christian in 75 to when I became a Christian in 77.
Keith's intense personality and immaturity as a believer were a volatile combination. He realized he was offending people for the wrong reasons. Lord, he wrote in his journal, change me, get rid of my radical tendencies. Help me control my overwhelming enthusiasm. People get wary if I go off the deep end instead of showing them I care.
And I watched this guy just take this fast track.
He finally found the truth. So he wanted everybody to know what he'd found, and he came on heavy.
It was a wonderful thing, and then quite often it could give you an Excedrin headache.
And he even, you know, went back to Randy, who had initially invited us to the Bible study, and started telling Randy how, well, you need to live your life like this, and the Bible says this.
He'd want to say, look, man, you know, why don't you, you know, live what you believe? And I'm going, I'm trying. It's not easy being human, you know. I'm glad it's better for you. And there were times when I want to say, Keith, you know, they made duct tape in rock and roll for a good reason. And one of them is to put this on your mouth.
They had some arguments, too, that I go, oh, no, they're fighting again.
I know you mean well, but look, put this on your mouth, go to your prayer closet, and come back and talk to me in about 3 years, okay? Because I love you, but I just want to throttle you, you know? And then I would look, and I would see Mel, the sweet...
You don't get a lot of true friends in life, people that see you're good, see you're not so good, and stick with you. And Randy was that kind of friend to Keith, and he's been that kind of friend to me for years.
As a young believer trying to imitate Christ, Keith's forceful manner began to collide head-on with his desire to serve others.
It was kind of just like a bull in a china closet. The heart was perfect, but the actions were bad.
He was indulgent 1 minute and then ruthless on himself the next. And that's a difficult temperament to live with. That's like riding rapids in your own emotions.
People would get very angry because he was the head of the line wherever there was a line.
His zeal quite often got ahead of his own emotional and spiritual maturity.
Keith's friends knew that he was sometimes abrasive, but always genuine. He took the gospel seriously and had the audacity to try to put the teachings of Christ into practice. If that meant life had to become messy, then so be it.
'Cause he sends people to your door, and you turn them away as you smile and say, God bless you, be at peace, and all heaven just weep. 'Cause Jesus came. Left him out on the streets.
Just in the normal course of life, wherever we went, you know, we were witnessing to people. And when we found people with needs, you know, Keith started saying, well, here's the pregnant girl, she doesn't know what to do, let's bring her home with us. And here's this guy we picked up hitchhiking, he doesn't have a place, let's bring him home. And our house just started to fill up with people that we, just as a young married couple, were trying to help.
In my heart of hearts, I only want to serve, Keith wrote in his journal. To present the babes as mature men and women of God. I want more than anything to pour myself out for them, for Jesus.
And he'd win them to Christ on the street, and they'd come live with him because they didn't have any place else to go. A lot of them were runaways.
you know, there he was trying to have Bible studies and to help these people. It was kind of a mid-70s version of a 60s hippie commune.
Keith was progressively surrendering more of his life to God, but his music career remained a huge question mark.
Keith had banged on every door in Hollywood to try and get a deal.
All he had to do is whisper in the valley that he was going to be somewhere, and it would just jam.
He's ready to go out there with Elton John and all those people, the same kind of craft, same kind of skill, charismatic, powerful.
I sat with him through a lot of auditions. You just go in and sit right there, play for the record company executives, and they're either, you know, thumbs up, thumbs down. I couldn't understand why he wasn't getting thumbs up.
He didn't need drums, guitars, backup singers. He just blew you away with he and the piano.
And the last big audition that he had was with Clive Davis, who was in New York, and they flew him out from California, and he thought, this is it. You know, I mean, Clive Davis, I'm at the top right now. He went in, auditioned for him. He called me up. He said, it didn't go well. That was the defining moment.
He had a whole pop music career planned, but God had told him he was supposed to be in the ministry.
He'd been wrestling now for a while. Does God want me to sing and make albums for Christians, or does he want me to continue trying to go out and sing to the world?
He didn't really want to do it. He'd been groomed to be a star.
And when he wasn't signed, he just said, well, I'm going to do a Christian album then.
He's brought me love so I could know the way to reach the
I said, what do I have to do to sign you to Sparrow Records?
For Keith, it was like the end of a lifelong quest.
You really belong on Sparrow. He says, probably so. That's where my friends are, and I know the kind of thing you're doing, and I'd really like to be on Sparrow.
He viewed, at that time, that Christians and that Christian music, per se, as, well, it's going to be really low budget, you know, it won't sound that well, and not that many people are really going to be able to hear the message of my heart.
So I sat there and worked out a contract with Keith on the back of a napkin.
Once Keith realized that that was God's will, he got very excited about it and really wanted to do it. I mean, he knew it was God.
So Keith signed with Sparrow, even though he was offered, I think, more money for some other people. It was very good.
Of course, little did we know at that point that, you know, God would use it the way that he did.
As Keith embraced the new path that was opening for him, he found unexpected freedom and a sense of calling. It was a time of intense chemistry and creativity.
Our house was really just this hub of musical energy. Everybody was writing. So Todd came over one day with, you know, and showing each other what he working on. So Todd had this song and played it for Keith. Keith loved the chorus. Your love broke through. I mean, he loved the music to it. And said, let's keep the chorus. We need another verse.
And the phone rings. And I pick it up. And it's Keith. And he's going, Randy, Todd Fishkin came by with this beautiful chorus melody, and I've been working on the verse melody, and you just got to come over and write the lyrics. God just told me that you're the guy, and he's just going to do wonderful things with this song, and you got to come over right now. And at this point, I was just like holding the phone away, going, it's Keith.
A really short time after that, Randy dropped in.
As I drove up into the driveway, I could already hear him. Although the music room was down the hall and sort of like toward the back of their house.
So Keith sat down and played it for Randy.
He just said, Randy, okay, listen to this. Okay, oh, this is going to be wonderful. Okay, so what do you think?
I remember hearing this amazing music, and I just was like, I'm not sure what they're doing right now, but this is one of the most beautiful songs I've ever heard.
Okay, just let me catch my breath. He went, yeah. You know, like, oh, Randy, you're such a wimp. Just do what you do, you know? And I went, oh, all right. Let me hear part of the melody again. He said, okay. So he was working on the verse melody, and I sat back and I said, okay, well, what about something like, like a dreamer who was trying to build a highway to the sky.
All my hopes would come tumbling down, and I never. why.
And he went, yes, praise God. See, I knew you were the guy.
Like waking up from the longest dream. How real it seemed until your love broke through.
When Keith went into the studio to work on his first record, he had written more than enough songs. The only challenge now was finding a way to capture his passion on tape.
For Him Who Has Ears to Hear was Keith's first album, for Sparrow, and it was a great experience.
He wanted Billy Maxwell to produce.
Billy called me and said, I have a new artist that's really good, and he's interested in you co-producing a record with him.
We met Billy Maxwell. Sparrow set us up with him.
Keith told me right off, he said, well, you know, you're not my first choice to do this. I wanted Buck Herring, but I know we'd end up killing each other.
By that time, I knew Keith well enough to know that that was never going to work.
There was no such thing in Keith's mind as warming up somebody.
I'm not sure I want to work with you either. Check it out. So I got into the music with Keith, listened to his tapes, and they were really good, but they kind of reminded me of other records.
At first, Keith tried to record like everyone else. He tracked the music, then stood at a microphone and sang. The result was lifeless. Everything that made Keith's music unique was bled out of the process. Keith and Bill tried over and over, but the raw energy just wasn't translating.
Bill would hear Keith play at a club or at our house, and he'd go, oh, this is great. Then they'd get in the studio, and, you know, where you track differently. And so Keith would stand up and sing, and it just, he couldn't get the sound, he couldn't get the feeling out of Keith.
Just the way he sounded, singing and playing live, was a lot better than he sounded on his records.
So Bill finally said, why don't you just sit down at the piano and play while you sing, even though it's not usually done that way.
He fed off of his piano playing in his energy and his voice. And he brought that energy and brought that quality to the industry that had not been there before.
And that was wonderful. I mean, they worked together, you know, the rest of Keith's life.
This organic style of recording was liberating. The sound was true. A re-energized Keith dug deeper into his faith and discovered new song ideas pouring out of him.
I found it hard to believe someone like you cared for me. You put this love in my heart.
When Keith recorded and you listened to the record, you had to be moved.
What he said was real. The music he played was real. It was alive. These words are true.
You know, he read the Bible constantly, and he would, because he was teaching these kids that came off the street, so he constantly reading.
Keith is singing with such enthusiasm about, you know, finding God, and a lot of excited songs.
You know, the word says, my word will stand forever. When you're out singing the word of God, and you're singing it with conviction, there's power behind it.
You could tell this guy was studying the Bible, because he was constantly coming up every day with new things to say in his music.
With his first record finally in the can, Keith hit the road for a grueling ministry tour.
He immediately went to the top in charts, and it sold 100,000 just right away, which was unbelievable in those days. Today it's like shipping 500,000 in today's market. It's just the biggest thing in the industry at that time.
Even Keith had to recognize the irony. Most of his life had been spent chasing a stardom that never materialized. Now, when his desire was simply to minister God's heart through music, he was suddenly catapulted to stardom.
Keith had a really hard time becoming what you might call a Christian celebrity. You know, being recognized, people coming up to him constantly.
He was not trying to be a star at all. He actually, once he got dedicated to the ministry, he was running from that.
You know, he couldn't just go into a church and be normal guy sitting in pew getting fed by Lord and worshiping.
I think oftentimes he felt overwhelmed by the responsibility of his calling.
He wanted God to say, well done, and he wanted the people he was ministering to, he wanted to be the one that pointed them to the Lord and not be applauded himself.
If you didn't come here to hear Jesus speak to you, you might as well go home. Because that's the only reason I'm here, is to let him speak.
He was uncomfortable with the fact that people worshipped him almost. He didn't want to be worshipped.
Keith said, look, if somebody writes a great poem, people don't run around, you know, applauding the pencil, saying, oh, what a great pencil. He said, I'm a pencil in God's hand.
He wanted people to focus on Jesus and on what he was telling them, not on him.
He wanted the Holy Spirit to come and for the atmosphere to remain one of ministry.
He'd walk out on the stage, people start applauding, and he'd say, you should be doing that for Jesus, not for me, and chew him out.
He felt like the preaching and the message in the music was the most important thing. He didn't ever want to go and just do a concert.
I want to tell you right now, I'm not afraid to say how you put the love in my heart.
The birth of Keith and Melody's first child, Josiah David, in the fall of 78 added a new and joyous dimension to their already busy lives. Keith's life had become a juggling act of family time, public touring, and community ministry. In the midst of this chaos, he wrote and recorded his second Sparrow release, No Compromise.
The album No Compromise was really an intense album. It had a lot of very pointed songs on it, and it was written in a whirlwind of being on the road, touring, and when we were at home we had all these people living with us. So it was just a lot of ministry going on publicly, but also privately. It wasn't like we went home and rested. It was like we went home and ministered again. No Compromise, you know.
So many times I've tried to tell you, but I don't think you've been listening. There's nothing I want to try and sell you, 'cause his love is free. You're so proud of saying you're a seeker, but why are you searching in the dark? You won't learn a thing until you soften your heart.
When touring took Keith and Melody to Hawaii in the late 70s, it proved to be a vision-shaping crash course on the need for international outreach.
We visited Hawaii. Keith was ministering there. And on this trip, we went to see the YWAM base that was there and met Lauren Cunningham, who founded YWAM. And that became just, you know, for the rest of Keith's life, a very deep connection and really impacted our ministry, because there was such a wealth of teaching within Youth with a Mission and such a wealth of great leaders. And so it was just kind of a turning point. It turned our hearts also towards missions.
With increasing success and an expanding vision came a new set of problems. The community ministry simply wasn't prepared to handle the sheer numbers that Keith's outreach was bringing in.
In California, Keith and I owned our own home. So that got filled up with like 14 people and a guy sleeping in the garage.
I think he was breaking every zoning rule in Los Angeles by putting up, you know, homeless people in this three-bedroom house, bunk beds, and people sleeping in the backyard.
We ended up buying the house next door, so we had two houses. We dormed that out, and then we rented another five houses in our neighborhood. It was all in about a three-square block area of Woodland Hills.
As they met people and saw what their needs were, they just had this real heart toward not wanting anybody, especially single women, to really have to take care of themselves.
They knew that we were Christians and having Bible studies because we invited all the neighbors.
At one time, we had seven houses and probably 65 people.
So then we became more organized. You know, dinners at this house, Bible studies at this house, girls' dorm is here, boys' dorm is there, single moms are over here.
We were kind of mixing rehab and discipleship. That was one of the hard parts, because you had people who really were troubled with people who really wanted just to know about God.
Then as it grew, it became more of a, you know, more of a program and discipleship, and people that already knew the Lord would come.
Everybody had something to do every day, whether you were working in the office and addressing envelopes, or whether you were cooking, or whether you were on a gardening group.
But the goal was to see people discipled and really to see people get to know Jesus through the people that we discipled.
A new tension was emerging. As money followed success, Keith grew uncomfortable. He couldn't stomach the idea of people paying to be ministered to.
Keith was very passionate about not charging for the gospel.
He had really felt
that the Lord had been asking him to do something that he didn't have the nerve to do.
And he did not want anybody to look at him and think that he was making money off the gospel.
He was impressed that all Christian artists should do offering concerts, should not sell tickets.
There was a lot of misunderstanding around it.
He was the first one, really, to bring in the idea of having big concerts where you didn't pay anything to come hear him sing.
I remember being in the back seat of a car coming from a Riverside concert that he did when Buck Herring was with him. And they got into an argument about whether or not it was right to charge for Christian concerts.
So he thought that was selling the gospel and that wasn't right.
And Keith just kept saying, if it's ministry, you cannot charge.
He put the burr under the saddle blanket and I had to start to keep digging and find out why it was there, you know.
He challenged everybody to be in that no compromise level.
Artistically, it was a time of uncertainty. With the release of No Compromise, Keith's contract obligation to Sparrow was over. Though he was unsure of the next move, he continued his constant touring.
When Keith finished his second album, by that time he was very well known.
It was going like crazy, and the two-record contract I had with him was over.
Yeah, I mean, I had some guys, I'm not going to name names, from other labels offering to, you know, like, slip me $25,000 under the table if I could get Keith to sign with the record company because he was that hot.
Sparrow still wanted him to re-sign, but there were other record labels courting him.
One of the record companies that was trying to lure him to a contract offered him stuff.
He felt like he was being taken up on a high mountaintop and being tempted by the devil.
I mean, he was like a commodity.
Keith really went back and thought, you know what? This isn't who we are. Who we are is Billy Ray. Who we are is the relationship that we have with Sparrow.
I have negotiated with him for another 2 years.
Keith now feared that he had compromised. He had signed a second contract with Sparrow and felt obligated to keep his word. On the other hand, he was convinced that to fulfill that contract would amount to selling the gospel for a profit. Keith was also concerned that some people who needed to hear his music wouldn't be able to afford it.
To obey is better than sacrifice. I don't need your money. I want your life.
He was just conscience stricken. Because he thought he really missed the Lord, even in resigning with Sparrow.
And he felt like he was not supposed to sell records.
And he said, I've got to go ask Billy Ray if he'll let me out of my contract.
I can still see him to this day on my back porch.
You know, when you've gone to tell somebody something that you think is probably going to be bad news and they don't know it yet.
And he said, I want out of my contract.
Keith told him, you know. But he really felt like he missed the Lord, that he loved him. It wasn't a personal thing, but that he thought he was supposed to be giving his albums away.
Well, that wasn't exactly what I wanted to hear. My biggest selling artist wanted to give his records away.
You know, you could hear a pin drop for a minute. But I don't think it took Billy Ray very long.
If God told him to do this, and he certainly is telling me to do this through Keith, and I had no other choice, really.
I remember feeling really surprised that he released him so quickly and so easily, but at the same time, not so surprised.
People think I was a great saint for doing that, but it was what God said, and you do what God says.
Keith moved from Sparrow as a label, while a different sort of move was looming for their community.
About the same time that the Lord was releasing us from Sparrow, we were also feeling released from California.
It was right after that that we really thought about moving to Texas.
We went specifically so we could have more land and really be out of the city, because some of the people we were trying to help, we just thought there's just too many temptations.
I can remember Keith standing on the corner by the freeway, kind of waving goodbye to his family.
We were a sight in Woodland Hills, but we were really a sight when we got to East Texas because we were just a scraggly bunch of hippies.
We drove up that driveway to which was just the ranch house when there was just one house.
It was just a cool house and had a barn. Quite quickly, we filled that up and then had to start building other buildings, other structures. And Keith was flying out so much that
it was a bit of a trek to the Dallas airport, so we thought, well, a little commuter plane would be good, and we had enough property in Texas to be able to put a little airstrip in for commuting back and forth to the airport.
After the move, Keith formed a new ministry label, Pretty Good Records. The Greens' second child, Bethany Grace, was born even as Keith plunged into the creation of his third record. So You Want to Go Back to Egypt was more musically impulsive than Keith's previous records, even boasting Bob Dylan on harmonica. But it wasn't anything stylistic that shocked the industry. It was Keith's radical plan for distributing the record.
He said, I don't believe people should pay to hear the gospel.
He wanted to figure out some way to get outside the system.
Pretty Good Records came out of that, and that's out of his desire not to want to charge anything for ministry whatsoever.
Of course, he had a mailing list of well over 300,000 people when he actually started Pretty Good Records and went outside the system and started offering his records for whatever people could afford.
And there were some times where a check would come in for a dollar that would say, this is all I could afford. And sometimes a check would come in for $5,000.
So You Want to Go Back to Egypt was a really diverse album. There was a lot of humor on it. Like, the title song was a funny song. We just cracked ourselves up writing it. We laughed so hard we were crying.
Part of the problem with Keith wanting to give the album away is what it did to all the other artists as well who had their albums in bookstores.
Nobody understood it. He tried to give his records through the bookstores and put signs on bookstores. Didn't understand it at all.
The way he did it, because he had so many other tools to make it work, the mailing list, the machinery, the ministry, etc., etc., it wasn't a model that the rest of us could follow. Necessarily, you know, at least nobody else jumped up and had the courage to follow him. I certainly didn't.
Keith was a constant innovator whose perpetual restlessness drove him to find new creative outlets. With the official formation of Last Days Ministries, he had begun to focus intently on discipleship through the print medium.
When Keith was about to make his first album, he, you know, knew it was coming. So as he was touring, he was collecting names saying, I'm going to have an album come out soon. And the album came out. These people wanted it. We mailed out the albums to them. And then he sat there and went, gosh, I've got 6,000 names here.
Keith loved this mailing list. He loved that these were people that he felt close to.
So he felt that we should communicate with them. So we started this little newsletter.
If you'd come in, he'd say, are you on our mailing list? And they would say yes or no, and then he would actually show them where their name was.
They were wise. They understood their audience, and they really spoke into the college dormitory. They spoke into the youth group, and they spoke into the heart of kids that had no relationship with Jesus at all.
Just started, you know, sharing our hearts, writing articles, that kind of thing. Keith was a real prolific writer.
It was overwhelming, the amount of letters that we got.
From that point forward, everywhere he went, if people wanted the newsletter, which eventually became a magazine, he'd always gather names.
Well, I'm going to take care of something before we go ahead with the evening. The ministry that I'm from puts out a magazine called The Last Days Newsletter. And it's a free magazine. We don't take advertising. It's just ministry. I write some articles. My wife does. Winky does. Different people in different ministries write articles in it. It also lets you know when other albums are coming out. And if you'd like to get that, we send it out once every 6 weeks. Fill out your name.
That magazine is an amazing phenomenon. It's huge circulation. It's youthful appeal. It's prophetic edge, the way it spoke to young people right where they were.
After the birth of their third child, Rebecca Joy, Keith sensed a need to break from their hectic schedules. He promised Melody a relaxing European vacation.
Our vacation turned into kind of this eye-opening ministry tour, and we went to Amsterdam and the Red Light District. We went down into Germany. We went into Switzerland. We flew over to Greece, and we were all with different missions leaders. So we both came back with this burning desire to just sort of awaken the church in America about the needs in other places.
Open your eyes to the world all around you. Open your eyes. Open your eyes. This world is much more than the things that surround you.
You must arise and open your eyes. Sometimes we're too busy to share, but Jesus wants us to care.
Keith's growing passion for international missions was fueled in part by a new understanding of God's grace at work in his own life.
The tension between law and grace was always evident with Keith.
He saw people taking advantage of the grace of God, and that annoyed him.
He had an outward bravado, but inside, he desperately wanted to please God and do the right thing.
He would make a promise to God, okay, you know, I'm going to read so many chapters of Bible every day before I get out of bed, and then it didn't happen. So he would feel like, I'm failing.
I remember telling him with as many word pictures as I could think of about the grace and tenderness of God as a father, using that image of the father heart of God.
He finally got to this place in that last year of his life where he knew that God accepted him and loved him just like he was.
He was starting to see the great compassion that God had for people. He was getting that for everybody.
I mean, he still had an edge. He was still Keith. It wasn't like he became this other person, but there was something in his heart that was really different.
God has seemingly two ways of looking at you. One is through the law, and one is through love.
Lord, the feelings are not the same. I guess I'm older. I guess I've changed. And how I wish it had been explained.
The whole issue of the nature and character and personality of God as a Heavenly Father became Keith's comfort.
He was beginning to rethink some of the ways that he had said things, and I saw him starting to just soften.
He came back to me a few weeks later and says, have you ever written that all down? Do you have a message on that? And I said, well, I just was telling you Jesus loves me, this I know.
Keith's mission focus and newfound understanding of grace converged in a plan to put together a rock band and evangelize the masses.
Songs for the Shepherd, that was just a real mandate from the Lord to do that album. Keith was going in a totally different direction. He was going to make a secular album, and went out on a prayer time, came back one day and just said, God redirected me, told me to do a worship album. So that album was his last one, and there were just some really touching things about that album to me. There was so much of his heart that went into it. When we were in the studio, the Lord just showed up on so many of the songs. You can hear it. You can hear it in Keith's voice.
Returning from a family fishing trip in July of 1982, Keith had good news to record in his journal. We have found out that Melody is pregnant. Thank you, Father. I truly pray this child is healthy. The journal entry continued on a more sobering note. Please, Father, I need your help. I am in great need of wisdom beyond my years and ability. Please help me redeem my time. Time was short. Keith Green would never meet his fourth child, Rachel Hope.
The day that the plane crashed, we had company coming over, and they had promised their kids an airplane ride. I just remember that day, it was like unusually hot, and Keith came running down, just busting through the doors, going, hey, we're going to go up in the plane now, and he wanted me to come with him. I said, no, I don't want to go, you guys go and see when you get back. And then Keith and I had this really odd conversation out of nowhere. Well, if I don't come back, he said, raise Rebecca to be a woman of God. And I said, well, okay. And so then I started thinking, well, I'm pregnant. So I said, well, if you don't come back, if I have a boy, do you want me to name him after you? Suddenly I had to know that. And he goes, no, it's fine. You don't need to. And so they just drove off. It wasn't that much longer that I got a phone call from our secretary. And she said, Melody, the plane went down. And I didn't know what it meant. The plane went down. Does it mean they're just sort of tipped over somewhere? What does that mean? And I just started driving up to the airstrip. And when I got up, I could see that everybody was running across the field because we had a lot of people there then. I got to the site of the of the crash, and I was just like running through the woods. I didn't know where I was going. They were unclear, you know, East Texas woods. And I was standing there realizing that they were just gone. And I remember I walked up to the airplane, and I remember the Lord just stopping me, just saying, "Don't look. What do you want to see? You know, what do you want to remember?" And I just kind of turned and walked away.
The tragedy instantly claimed the lives of 12 people. The entire Smalley family, John, Dee Dee, and their 6 children perished alongside Keith, Josiah, Bethany, and ministry pilot Don Burmeister. Keith was only 28 when he died.
And 2 of my children died with Keith also. And it's a different loss. Each was devastating, but for me, you know, to lose a husband and lose children is very hard.
Melody in the stunned last days community struggled to comprehend the loss.
When I got that phone call, it plunged me into grief.
I remember when Keith had died, and other half the people were saying, "Oh, it was the Lord," and half the people were saying, "Oh, the enemy did this." And I said, "You know what? It was an accident."
But even as they grieved, they began to consider how God might turn this tragedy to His glory.
I was afraid suddenly to be single and alone, a single mom. And I heard this phrase drop into my mind, grain of wheat. I got a Bible and found the grain of wheat scripture. And it says, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. He fell to the ground. He was a grain of wheat. But his life was going to bear much fruit.
People really began to think, what was the last things that he said? And that led to the memorial concert tour.
It was such an instant loss for people who loved Keith and loved his music that it was like a place where you could come and say goodbye, but then we hit him with the mission's message.
Jesus commands us to go, but we go the other way.
We would put on the big screen those last messages in which there was that very strong call for young people to become missionaries.
It was like this incredible new direction. And you know, he didn't really get to fulfill it in the way that he thought he was going to, but I think the message did get delivered.
In his death, there was dramatic impact on organizations like Operation Mobilization and Youth of the Mission. People that are still out there today because of the passion of his message.
Countless thousands of people committed their lives to global ministry as a direct result of Keith's final challenge. The example of his unyielding commitment and passion for his Creator spurred others to surrender their lives wholly to the call of God, even long after his death. Because Keith's message was really a simple call to live out the gospel, it remains as relevant today as when he first sang and spoke it.
Our call is not only overseas, it is every day. It is making our lives count every day. That just doesn't change. It just wasn't Keith's idea that we need to go. You know, it was God's idea.
I guess it's been 23 or 24 years since the first album. It's still moving. All this music is still having an impact on people, which is incredible.
A whole new generation is discovering it. I can see that. I have 3 sons, and they all have rock bands, and they all love Keith Green's music, and are discovering it again right now.
Maybe the young people will study what really made him, and that was his openness to God and his willingness to be in that no-compromise attitude.
Keith said that he wanted to be remembered as a Christian, somebody who really loved God, somebody who just gave his all to Jesus.
Even if just 2 people or 1 person came to Christ through his death, I still would think it was worth it. Through the pain came so much more glory that lots of people would never expect that would happen. I think he was someone that said, "Okay, God, I am going to really lay my life at your feet." And I think he's just an example of
what anyone could do if they really were willing to give God everything.
I think the reason his music is so loved today by young people is because it does challenge them to be radical, to give 100%, to care about the lost. Even if it costs you your life, do it. You know, that's worth giving up all the other stuff for, because that's what they're longing for. This all-out 100% commitment to Jesus.
Melody, Rebecca, and Rachel now look forward to the day when their family will be forever reunited. Melody eventually moved back to Southern California, where she continues the ministry Keith began. Rebecca and Rachel are now at the age their father was when he started his music ministry. Both are pursuing God and actively seeking his purpose for their lives.
Like a foolish dreamer trying to build a highway to the sky, all my hopes would come tumbling down, and I never knew just why. Until today, when you pulled away the clouds that hung like curtains on my eyes. All these wasted years, and I thought I was so wise, but then you took me by surprise. Like waking up from the longest dream I've really seen, until you love. You just rolled away the stone that held my heart, and now I see that the answer was as easy as just asking you in, and I am so sure I could never doubt your gentle touch again. It's like
information on Keith Green's music, ministry, and message, visit keithgreen.com.